sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes the whole earth?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all.
Can you sing, this is amazing grace?
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
You would lay down.
You would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Thank you. Good morning. Why don't you grab a seat for just a minute for me? This year, we're going to be sending out 3 global exposure trip teams. So 40 people from SBC are going to be traveling around the world to see what God's up to in other countries. We're going to send 2 teams to Costa Rica, one over here at spring break, and then another one in the summer with Students International. And then we're going to send a 3rd team to Thailand this next year. And so we're going to do something this morning that's unique for us, the first time we've ever done this, and we're calling it affectionately Pass the Bag. And so for these teams that are going overseas, they need lots of support. They need prayer support, and they also need financial support. And so we wanted to give you an opportunity to support those who are going to be traveling and seeing what God's up to. And so if I could have those who are going to pass the bag come forward. We call it an exposure trip on purpose, and that's because we want to be exposed to what God's doing in other places. Sometimes we get caught in our own little world, and we don't recognize that God's at work all over the world. And so we want to go see what God's doing and then join the other organizations that are boots on the ground that are doing stuff there. And so these guys are going to pass this around. If you'd like to support above and beyond your normal tithe, you can do that. If you're anything like me and you don't always carry cash, we also have a QR code that you can scan, and that'll take you to our giving page. Also, if you're online, you can go to our giving page. Click on the drop-down menu that says Pass the Bag, and that's another way that you can support these teams. And so as we enter into a time of worship through music again while they're passing the bag, can I just encourage y'all, be praying for the folks that are going to be traveling. Be praying for the details and the fundraising and the safety and all the things that go into being on a global exposure trip, okay? All right.
Shining the shadow, you win every battle. Good morning. My name is Alyssa. I'm here on behalf of West African Vocational Schools. You guys may have seen myself and my coworker Crystal set up out in the lobby. We would love to chat with anybody who wants to hear more about what we do after the service. Or I know Scott will share, or somebody will share, that we will be meeting after the third service to have some lunch and share about the trip to West Africa that we just took. So today I have the privilege of reading the verses that we're going to be covering in the sermon. So if you guys want to, if you have your Bibles with you, go ahead and turn to Jude, the book of Jude, and we're going to be reading verses 8 through 10 together today. So, okay, Jude 8 through 10. Yet in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. But when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. God, thank you for a beautiful Sunday to come together to worship, to share in our love for you. Thank you, God, that you are not only the God of Sanger and Fresno and Clovis, but also the God of Guinea-Bissau and every country and community in between. We thank you that the people here have a great love not only for you, but for your people. And I just celebrate working with this community to bring West Africans closer to the knowledge of you and closer to the reality of having a full and happy life. And we thank you again for all that you're about to teach us, and we pray in your son's name, amen.
Good morning, Sangamaro. There it goes. Hey, everyone, how's everybody doing this morning? Doing good? Man, I had this opening ready to go. I wasn't going to like stutter or anything like that. Then my mic goes out. And so, well, welcome to Sanger Bible. We are a community of imperfect people in pursuit of the one and only perfect Lord, Jesus Christ. And so to those watching us online, welcome. Thank you guys for joining us. Jude, verse 8, 9, and 10. Man, hasn't this letter that Jude pens to the church been interesting? Like, man, he has been clear with his words. He has been concise with his phrases. He has been concrete with his meanings. Remember how he started. He started out by reminding his readers who he is and who they were, called, loved, and kept. He then went on to say, hey, I'm going to pray for you that God's mercy, peace, and love would grow in you and multiply in you. Then he got straight to the point in verse 3 on why he was writing to them. He was like, hey, you guys need to contend for the faith. Why? Verse 4, because false teachers, fake followers, wolves in sheep's clothing had crept into the church and they're corrupting the church. They're abusing God's grace light as a license to sin and ultimately rejecting Jesus as Lord. And so he's urging the church to contend for the faith. And to encourage them, he reminds them in verses 5, 6, and 7 of things that has happened to false teachers and fake followers of Jesus back in the day. And so he brings up a couple of stories that they knew exactly of who had denied and rejected God and they suffered the consequences. He said, remember those who were saved out of Egypt who questioned God after he saved them. He said, remember those angels who left their position of authority, who left heaven. He said, remember those in Sodom and Gomorrah who purposely participated in sexual immorality, who didn't care for God. All those folks, they knew the truth. They knew God, his will and his ways, but they questioned him. They thought they knew better, and they turned from him. And because of that, they suffered the consequences of God's judgment. I used the word last week that it's not seen in Jude's letter, but it's called the apostate. It means somebody who knew one thing, who knew the truth, but they turned and rejected the truth. These people in Jude's letter he's talking about are apostates. and he's warning the church about apostates. And in the first seven verses, he has not stuttered. He does not hold back. He has been clear, concise, and concrete with his message. Today, we are in Jude verses 8, 9, and 10. And he's going to give us a more of a detailed description of these false teachers and fake followers. He's going to show us their way of thinking in the beginning of verse 8. And then the rest of verse 8, he's going to give us three characteristics of these folks. And then in verse 9, he's going to give an interesting contrast to verse 8. And then verse 10 is going to be a continuance of the characteristics of these fake followers. Church, there's two ways I want us to apply this text today. Number one, what we're going to learn today is what we need to be on the lookout for in false teachers and fake followers of Jesus Christ. So many people are being led astray by wolves in sheep's clothing. They're being wooed by people's charisma. Their ears are being tickled by churches saying the things that they want to hear. And so because of that, many people are following them. We need to be on the lookout. We need to understand what Jude is saying so we can point it out and walk away and run away if we have to. The second thing that we're going to learn today is before, as we talk about those people, the false teachers and the fake followers, let's be slow to see them as those people. Because the truth is, we too are those people. The things that Jude says today, it may not be explicit within the body of Christ here, but it's all over. It's all over. And so we need to hear what Jude is saying so that we can understand what to look for, but at the same time, be able to hold up the mirror and ask the tough questions. Is this found in me today? The very people that Jesus allowed to accuse him and to arrest him, to trial him, to beat him, to crucify him, and to bury him, those very people have been immoral in their behavior, arrogant in their attitude, ignorant in their understanding. Yet, Jesus humbly does all these things for them and for us so that we would have salvation through him, so that we would live today contending for the faith, so that others would hear, listen, and know and place their faith in Jesus Christ. So Jude 8, 9, and 10. Let's begin. Verse 8. Yet, in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glory ones. Remember the examples that he gave last week in verse 5, 6, and 7. What these people did years ago in verse 5, 6, and 7, how they questioned God, denied God, and defied God. Jude is saying, it's happening right now in the church. Church members, leaders, and pastors are questioning God. Church members, leaders, and pastors are manipulating God's word. Church members, leaders, and pastors are blatantly disregarding God's design and his will for this life. Sounds like he's writing this letter to America, right? Like, don't we see this around the churches today? People questioning, manipulating, and blatantly disregarding God's design and his will for this life. Notice back at verse 8, yet in like manner, these people also, he tells us like their thinking, how they think, their description of what they're thinking, relying on their dreams. Relying on their dreams. One of the ways that God would speak to the prophets in the Old Testament was he would show up in visions and dreams. This is how God spoke to Jeremiah, Daniel, Ezekiel, and Isaiah. He would show up and give them a vision. He would show up while they were sleeping in a dream, and then therefore they'll go on and speak. This is what God told me in my dream. This is the vision that God told me in my dream. What Jude is saying is these false teachers and fake followers, these wolves in sheep's clothing, they're doing the same. They knew their Old Testament book, and so therefore they're going around, God spoke to me in my dream. Last night, God told me this, fill in the blank. And so they would use that to control and to manipulate the church. and people listen. And so they'll take advantage and capitalize by appealing to their wants and needs of the people in the church, tickling their ears with saying all the right things, saying just enough to sound biblical, claiming that God spoke to them in their dreams. I don't hear much about it today when people say, hey, I had this dream. Every now and then, but more so, I hear, the Lord told me this, Pete, and fill in the blank. The Lord told me this, fill in the blank. Pete, God wants me to be happy. Oh, but you're intentionally living in sin. Yes, but he wants me to be happy above everything else. He told me that. See, what happens is, that's right on time. So good. So good. See, folks that are watching online, it's much better to be here in person. There's little things that just happen like that. So good. Whenever folks say things, hey, Pete, man, this is what the Lord has told me. We have to make sure it lines up with Scripture. And 99% of the time, it doesn't. And the reason why it doesn't is because they've fantasized, they've relied on their dreams for such a long time that their dreams had become a reality in them, has become filter for them. And so they can't see anything else but their dreams. Typically, the first step to apostasy is fantasy. James tells us in James chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, but each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. Then when that lust has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. These fake followers, these false teachers have created a whole new reality, a fantasy world, you could say, and that's leading them to deny and refuse God because now they think they're their own gods. Look at the characteristics that he lists in verse 8. Yet in like manner, these people also relying on their dreams, he says, they defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. The defiling the flesh that Jude is speaking of is literally polluting yourself with sexual sin. This can be done physically through any kind of sexual act outside of God's design, and this can be done mentally by being exposed to the things that lead to sexual sin. This is what the angels were doing. This is what was happening in Sodom and Gomorrah. And so what Jude is saying, hey, this is happening. People are participating and engaging purposely in defiling the flesh. This is happening in the church today. Along with defiling the flesh, they rejected authority. Remember in verse 5, those in the wilderness who rejected Moses' authority. Remember verse 6, the angels who left their heavenly positions, they rejected God. Remember verse 7, those in Sodom and Gomorrah, they rejected God's authoritative design. What these false teachers and fake followers are doing is they're rejecting authority, they're taking control, and then they're placing themselves above everything else. They really, truly believe that they know better. Listen to what Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 16 and 17. Avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their walk will spread like gangrene. People who reject God's authority in churches, most of the time they have a leadership role. And in that role, they become very creative with their speech. They're charmers. They're natural salesmen. And they say just enough stuff to get you to think, oh man, they're solid followers. But when you get to know them deep down inside, they are in charge of themselves. They actually reject God. They are their own authority. Look at the spread of the celebrity pastors. Look at the spread of the prosperity gospel. People have placed themselves above all things. God is under them. And so they've essentially made people think that they are the prophets. Literally, I saw a video this week of a pastor who literally told his church, it was like, I have the highest seat in this world. I am his number one communication prophet to this world. And so if you want to be blessed, this is literally him. If you want to be blessed, Give me all that you have and he will bless you in return. And then he literally goes on, he's like, I need 10,000 people to give $1 million, something ridiculous like that. Hey, can we pass those bags around again? This is happening in churches today. And probably what's the most sad, but it has to be said here. People have rejected God's authority and they place themselves as authority and they use their authority to abuse people sexually. They use their authority to guilt people to doing favors. This is not God's church. And Jude is saying, this is happening. This is happening. And then lastly, he says, they blaspheme the glory ones. Some of your translations have revile angels. And so glory ones are angels. And what Jude is talking about here, he's pointing out their pride. You know how they defile the flesh, that reject authority. Why? Because they have such a high view of themselves. And now what he's saying is they have such a high view of themselves, they're talking down to angels. They're talking down to the glorious ones. They're cursing at them. They're slandering them. They're speaking profanely about them. Why? Basically because they think they're above everyone. This is how prideful these people were. They viewed themselves even above the angels. Then you get to verse 9. It's an interesting contrast. And so for us to understand this, there's a few questions, but let me read verse 9 first. But when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, the Lord rebuke you. Interesting, right? Okay, to make sense of this, there's a few questions we need to answer in order for us to really understand what Jude is saying. Where is the story from? Who is this Michael guy? And why is he arguing with the devil over Moses' body? First, where's this story from? Nobody really knows where this story from, but what we do know that this story is a traditional Jewish story. It's found in a few non-scriptural books, one, The Assumption of Moses, and a few others. But so we're not sure where it comes from, but what we do know is the original readers of Jude's letter, they would have read this, and they would have automatically connected themselves to the Jewish traditional story that they had known for years. And so that's what we know. The question is, why does Jude insert that here? Why in this book? Like, remember, he only has 25 verses. One of those verses is verse 9 when he does this contrast of Michael. So we're not sure. So let's answer the next question. Who is Michael the archangel? We find him in two books. We see him in the book of Daniel a few times, and in it they call him one of the chief princes of the spiritual realm who stand guard over God's people. So that's a pretty cool role. In the book of Revelation, Michael is mentioned too in Revelation chapter 12, verse 7 and 9. Listen to this. There is a war in heaven. Michael and his angels are waging war with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels waged war. And they were not strong enough, and there was no longer a place found for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, and the serpent of the old, who is called the devil and Satan, who receives the whole world, has been thrown down to earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. In Revelation, it is clear that there is a war happening with the devil and Michael. What Jude is talking about here is not the same battle with the devil. It's a different time, which leads us to the next question. Why are he and the devil disputing over Moses' body? What we do know is Moses' body was buried in Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 5. And 6, it reads this. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord, and he buried him in the valley of the land of Moab. But no man knows his burial place to this day. So nobody knows where Moses' body lays. So why is Michael and the devil fighting over it? There's two theories. One theory is the devil knows how susceptible God's people are when it comes to worshiping idols. And so his thinking was like, man, if I can get Moses' body, if I can put it right in front of God's people, they're gonna be so into it and they're gonna worship his body. His body will become an idol now. And what's that gonna do? That's gonna distract them from truly worshiping the one true Lord. That's theory number one. Theory number two is the devil's trying to prevent a future ministry of Moses. In Revelation chapter 11, there's a prophecy that there's two witnesses who are going to come about and help God in his finished work on the end days. Listen to this. It says, Revelation 11, verse 3, I will appoint my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. And so these two witnesses will have a message. They will have great powers. They'll be successful, but eventually they're going to get caught up. They're going to get killed, but then they will resurrect in 3 days and ascend into heaven. Some believe that one of those two witnesses is going to be Moses. And so that's why the devil wanted his body, to prevent a future ministry of Moses. I don't need to lean a certain way. Maybe it was for both. I don't know. But what we do know is Michael and the devil are fighting over Moses' body. So why is it inserted here by Jude? In the previous verse, verse 8, you see the pride, don't we? The pride of these false teachers, these fake followers, these wolves in sheep's clothing. They defy the flesh, they reject authority, they blaspheme the glory ones. These people thought of themselves as greater and higher than even the angels. Now what we see here in verse 9 is Jude is showing his readers humility. Humility from the highest, one of the highest angels, Michael. You see, instead of putting himself in a position outside of his authority, like how other angels, Michael shows humility. Michael shows trust. Michael shows understanding of the Lord. And so he doesn't do what the false leaders, false teachers and fake followers do, where they speak out of position, where they live outside of God's authority. No, he contends for the faith by staying in his lane. He contends for the faith by humbly leaving to God what God is in control of. That's why he says he did not presume to pronounce blasphemous judgments, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Instead of speaking out of his place, instead of speaking out of his position, instead of speaking out of his authority, Michael humbly trusts in the Lord and that the Lord will take care of it. Michael understands and trusts that God will obey his promise in Romans 12, that vengeance is his. Then he goes on in verse 10. But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. Instead of submitting to the truth, trying to understand it, false teachers mock the truth. Fake followers distort the truth. Apostates criticize the truth. They insult and make fun of what they don't understand. And like unreasoning animals, they are blinded by their pride. They act on their instincts. They move on their feelings. They thrive within emotions. They quench the flesh and they gratify desires, ultimately, which leads them to their destruction. When you zoom out and look at verses 8, 9, and 10, what's visible is the immorality of these false teachers in verse 8. What's clear as day is the arrogance of these fake followers in verse 9. And what's sad is their ignorance due to their lack of understanding in verse 10. Remember the two applications I wanted us to take away from this text? What we see here in verse 8, 9, and 10 is what we need to be on the lookout for in church leaders and pastors and other followers. We need to be looking out at their livelihoods. Are they living in accordance to God's design? Are they living in accordance to God's design for relationships? Are they married? Are they single? Are they pursuing holiness? Or are they pursuing happiness? What about their attitudes? Like, are they prideful of themselves? Are they arrogant of their work? Are they controlling in their structure? Are they condescending from the pulpit? Is there fruit of the Spirit? Or do you see fruit of arrogance? Are their actions instinctive like animals, or are they reflective of a new life in Christ? See, churches are filled today with members, leaders, and pastors who are leading many astray, and they're creative in their speeches. They're saying what people want them to say. And typically what they say is these messages that lift you up, that encourage you, that include these phrases that you are amazing. Your destiny is here today. Your time is now. Your tomorrow is today. Your storm is about to be over. You deserve to be happy. They say all these phrases that begin with you, you, you. And the reason why they're doing that is they're trying to get into your head, into your mind, your understanding that you are above God and God exists to serve you. That's what they're trying to do. They're trying to get you to be selfish and be like, oh yeah, God exists for me, to serve for me. And then they get you, give all that you can and God will give you all that you desire. They puff you up. They get you to trust them. So then you reject the Lord and walk away. These folks are typically controlling. Everything always has to be about them, goes through them, and only happens when they say so. And if you look closely, they live instinctively like animals, bowing to the things of the flesh, all because they rather please their desires than try to understand God's design and will. Church, when you see it, hear it, and experience it, run. 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 Now, before I go on to the second application, let me say this real quick. We need to take verse 9 into consideration. Remember how we're supposed to contend for the faith, right? There are going to be times when we are going to have to humble ourselves and walk away from a fight and trust that God has that in control. This is big because we can and will get into contention, contending for the faith, and things are going to get personal. And when things get personal, typically we double down, be like, oh, nah, now I'm winning. I'm going to win this argument. And before you know it, we've doubled down and we're trying so much to win in the moment. And then we act out of position. We speak out of authority as if we are a high angel or anything like that. And so what we see here in verse 9 is Michael, the archangel, he was like, you know what? I'm going to stay in my lane. God will take care of you. And so there's going to be times when we are contending for our faith, well, we're going to have to humble ourselves and trust that God has this. Part of contending you for the faith is probably you walking away. That's where you need the discernment of the Holy Spirit working in you. Because sometimes we stay into a fight and we start saying things and we end up in sin when we should have walked away a long time ago. Second, as we just learned about those people, the false teachers, the fake followers, let's be slow to seeing them as those people. Because the truth is, we are those people. Defiling the flesh in church, people are participating and engaging in sexual sin, spouses cheating on spouses, premarital sex, this pornography, child abuse, same sex, everything is happening in the churches today as we speak. There's a rejection of authority. It's visible. We live in a time right now where everyone is entitled. Like everyone believes they are owed something, and when they don't get that something or that status or that role or that title, they throw a tantrum. And they either go and start their own church, or they stay within the church, and then what they start doing is they start criticizing everything from behind. They start leaking rumors, gossip, Why? Because they know everything. They're above everybody. Eventually, that leads them to not even caring for God's will or his design for this life any longer. And so they kick God's design to the curb and they kind of make up their own as they go. This is everywhere in the church, intentionally too. And so before we get on a high horse and kind of point at those people, let's humble ourselves and remember we are those people too. What I appreciate the most about today's verses is the exact opposite of everything that Jude just talked about today is Jesus. Jesus. He didn't defile the flesh. He lived a pure and holy life. He lived out God's design for us to see and follow. Instead of rejecting authority, he humbly submitted to God's will. He believed in God's plan. He came as a servant to serve and led him to suffer on the cross. And instead of not caring for God's design and his plan and his will, he trusted God's plan, God's design and his will. Yes, sure, he even questioned, like, God, is there any other way? That's us humans. That's what we do. Is there any other way? If not, whatever your will, I will do. And he did that. And so he trusted in God's plan by relying on God through the Father, through prayer, through solitude, Sabbath, fasting, and service. Church, this is why we can't get tired of his death, burial, and resurrection. Because as Jude talks about, people immorally living, people arrogantly living, and people just ignorant, we must remember that Jesus Christ was accused, was arrested. He was trialed. They beat him. They crucified him. They buried him. And the very people who are immoral in their behavior, arrogant in their attitude, ignorant in their understanding, those very people are the people that Jesus died for. And so before we say, look at those people, that's us. That's us. And this is why Jesus doesn't do anything as he's handcuffed, as he's whipped, as he dies on the cross, because he knows without him, we don't get to be with God the Father. And so, may we humble ourselves. May we humble ourselves and remember that Jesus was betrayed, that he was accused, that he was beaten, mocked, and scorned. That he wore the crown of thorns, that he was held up on the cross to purchase and redeem you. That's the faith you and I contend for. That's why we pursue holiness. This is why we submit to his authority. This is why we trust in his plans. Let's pray. Jesus, help us. Help us discern. Help us see the face of the false teachers and the fake followers. Help us walk away from them, but at the same time, pray for them. Jesus, first and foremost, I lift up to you the church here in America. I pray that we would confess and repent and turn back to you. The pride that's in us, I'm sure it's grieving you, Jesus. And so, Holy Spirit, call us back. Turn us around to see you. I lift up to those in here right now that are intentionally in sin. As we hold up the mirror and ask the questions how we're defiling the flesh, rejecting authority and just not trusting in your plans, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you bring those to our forefront, that we would think about it, that we would pray about it, and that we will tell somebody about it. Confess and repent. Jesus. We love you, and that you died for us. You experienced all of that so that we may have life. We give you all the praise. Amen.
God.
rugged cross.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Chandra. I'm the Kids Co coordinator, program coordinator here at Sanger Bible.
Good morning or buenos dias. My name is Joe, or Jose, like my wife calls me. I'm in charge of facilities here. And Chandra, let me tell you something. As I was reflecting of today's message, God's Word, aren't you grateful for God's Word? Amen, I am. You know, it challenges me in two ways, and I hope it challenges you in two ways as I want to leave this in your heart today. Number one is be mindful. I love what my friend Scott Carolyn says. Be mindful. We need to live our lives mindful of what we're hearing, what we're watching, what we're scrolling down on our social medias. As we have heard of the characteristics, all these false teachers, be mindful of their language. Be mindful of their testimony. Be mindful of what you're scrolling down this week. And the second thing I want to leave with your heart is this, and Pete said it too, allow God's Holy Spirit to reveal to you some of maybe those characteristics that already are in us because we're listening to false teachers, false teaching. So ask God's Holy Spirit through showed you those areas of your life that you need to submit to his authority, because ultimately, we need to be mindful that it's all about Christ, and if Christ needs to be the center of our lives. And this is not easy. I'll tell you this is not easy. That's why the Bible says we're to live in community. So if you're here for the first time at SBC, we'd love to get connected with you. One of the ways we do it is just fill out that welcome card, take it to the connection center or drop it in the tie box. Maybe you've been here for a while. Maybe your address changed, or maybe you just need prayer. Like, God, you know, put in that connect card, I need prayer, I need discernment, I need you guys to walk along with me. And we'd love to help you do that through a cup of coffee, a burrito, or whatever. But the most important thing is this cannot be done alone. We need each other.
Yeah, amen. And if you are new, a great next step for you would be to join us for Discovery, which will be this Tuesday at 6:30. And Discovery is just that. You get to discover about Singer Bible Church. You get to come and hang out with Pastor Pete, and he will share the heart of our church, our values, and you'll get to eat. So, spoiler alert, one of our values is food. So. It's perfect. But we would love for you to join us. If you're not new, but you've never done Discovery before, please come and join just so you can hear the heart. But that is this Tuesday at 6:30.
Amen. You know, one of the things I learned that is that God is an international God. And God's people say amen to that. Because God, sometimes we're here in the Western world, we're in a bubble thinking that God only speaks English. All right, but how many of you know that God speaks different languages? All right, so I'm from Nicaragua, so obviously I'm biased, and Spanish is the language of heaven. Okay, so but pray for me, okay? But where am I going with this? Okay, where am I going with this? There's an invitation to you this morning for our third gathering to hear what God is doing in Guinea-Bissau, what God is doing through people who are saying, here, Lord, here's my life. And as we get to hear stories of what God is doing through this school. You know, I went down. They have a table in the back where you can get some more information. I got Marcos. Marcos is one of the computer students, and you can pray for them. So you can take one of the cards and be praying for them during the week. But I want to invite you today after our third gathering to come and hear through Tim and through the people that went with him. There's videos, there's pictures of just, it's so important to hear. It's different when you hear it from a person that has been there, and you see pictures and you see what God is doing. And just come, we'll feed you and come in here, and hopefully you get to see that God is an international God.
Amen. That's just going to be really cool. Our last announcement is our really fun Lego Masters transportation. So any kind of transportation, car show, if you will, that we're having. Singer gets every year does a Blossom Trail Festival. They do a bunch of fun stuff out on Main Street, but we also get to do some fun stuff over here. There's a car show that happens right outside of our building. And then we get to open our doors to our community and let our kids come in and bring all their cool creations. So if your kid wants to be a part of that, they can too, but they get to build any type of transportation. They'll bring it in here. They'll put it where it belongs. We'll have Legos out for kids to play with. We'll have a fun drawing of Lego guy. You can create your own Lego guy or girl. And we'll have popcorn and a movie. And it's just so much fun for us to open our doors and love on our community. But with that said, we really do need your guys' help. So if that is you and you'd love to volunteer, please jump on the Church Center app and sign up, or you can head on to the back where the connections is. But it's just a really awesome time for us to show our community Jesus while we get to have fun with Legos, which is so cool. So if you feel like you would love to help with that, we would really love your help. With that being said, just a reminder of what Joe shared with us and Pete as well, of just remembering what we're letting in our brains and our minds and what we're watching and thinking, but just that we pray to Jesus this week that he will reveal to us our stuff. What are we doing? And that we can lay those down at his feet and humbly follow him this week. We love you all. We hope you have an amazing Sunday, and go be the church.